Hi, it is time for the second presentation, which is achieved by Dominique Feillet, who is professor at the École des Mines de Saint-Étienne at Garden.
Thank you. Okay, so the topic of the presentation will be clone generation and branch and price. And the idea is to avoid being too much theoretical, try to be very practical and explain on a simple example how you can apply clone generation if you have to develop algorithm with this technique. So what I'm going to do is to illustrate clone generation applied to a standard vehicle routing problem, the vehicle routing problem with time windows. So it will be really a step-by-step presentation of the method. And the idea is that at the end of the presentation, you have a better understanding of the method, and then tomorrow with Thierry Garret, you will have practical session, if you want, that you can attend, and when you will implement the method. And then it should really give you all the elements that you need to be able to do it on your problem if you need it. So as Philippe told, I'm from École des Mines de Saint-Étienne. Just some explanation about this picture. So this is a painting by Paul Cézanne, and this is a painting of the city of Gardanne, which is the place where I'm located actually. So I'm not in Saint-Étienne, I'm in Gardanne, near Aix-en-Provence and Marseille, so really in the south of France. So I have included this picture, and you will see that on all the title slides of the presentation, you will have this kind of iconic pictures of Provence. So the idea is to remind you that I'm not from Saint-Étienne, I'm from the south of France. That's also, it's a way to say that it's a beautiful region and that I have some possibility of postdoctoral and PhD position. So if you're interested, you will see what you will find there. So this is the outline of the presentation. You will see. I introduce clone generation, the main principle, and then some details on implementation and the different components, the pricing problems, the branch and price part, some conclusion. So as I said, I will illustrate the presentation on the vehicle routing problem with time windows. So what is the vehicle routing problem with time windows? I will go quickly because you just had a presentation by Christian Prince on vehicle routing problems. So you consider a graph. Mainly I'm going to introduce the notation. So the graph is denoted G. V is a set of vertices with V0 being the depot and V1 to Vn the customers, so you have n customers, and you have a fleet of U vehicles that have to start from the depot, serve some customers and come back to the depot. These vehicles have capacity constraint, so the capacity is denoted Q, capital Q, and each customer has a demand, Di. And so a route is feasible with regard to the capacity if the sum of the demands of the customers visited in a route is less than the capacity of the vehicle. And also you have to satisfy time windows. So it means that when you reach a customer, it's possible to arrive before time AI, but then you will have to wait because AI corresponds to the opening time of the customer. So it's possible to start the service of the customers at time AI. At least. It's not possible to start it before. And if you arrive after time BI, it's too late, it's closed, which means that you have to visit the customer before time BI. And you have a service time STI. Then you have travel cost, CIG, on arcs. You assume that the triangle inequality is satisfied. And so the objective of the problem is to visit all the customers respecting capacity constraint and time windows and at a minimum cost with the U vehicles. Okay, so when we discuss about clone generation, we discussed about exact solution of the problem. So we are not talking anymore about meta heuristic and this kind of things. We want to solve exactly the problem, and we will rely on mathematical formulations. And the very standard compact formulation of the problem is this one. So in this formulation, that is very typical of what you can have in vehicle routing problem, you have this kind of variable xigu, meaning that, so these are binary variables, xigu is equal to 1 if vehicle u travels through arc ig, so goes from customer or vertex I to vertex G. So these are the binary variable, and so this is quite easy to understand. You minimize the total cost. So each time an arc is selected, you're going to pay cost CIG. You have to satisfy all customers. So what you can see on the left-hand side is outgoing flow from vertex I. So if I is a customer, the outgoing flow has to be at least one, meaning that you have to visit these customers, meaning that you have to perform the service at this customer. You have flow balance constraint, so when a vehicle enters the customer, it has to leave. Each vehicle can only start once from the depot, so you cannot reuse several times the same vehicle. So it's not multi-trip VRP. When you start from the depot, you come back to the depot, and that's the end with this vehicle. You cannot restart. These are for capacity constraint. So for each vehicle, you have to satisfy capacity constraint. So you sum the demand of the customer served by the vehicle, and it has to be not more than Q. And these one are for time windows. So SIU are other variables. These one are not binary, they are continuous variables. And they indicate the service time at customer I. So SIU is the service time at customer I by vehicle U. Is vehicle U is the one that execute the service. If vehicle U is not used to serve customer one, this variable still exists, but it doesn't any meaning. So this variable has to be between AI and BI, so inside the time window. And this constraint compute the service time. So big M is a large value. If the variable is equal to zero, xigu equal to zero, the constraint is not active because you have the big M on the right-hand side. And so the constraint is not active. On the contrary, if you use arc IG with vehicle U, the big M can be removed on both sides. And it means that the service time at I plus the time to serve I, so the starting time of service at I plus the time for the service plus the time to go from I to G is less than or equal to the starting time of the service at G. So this way you compute the starting time at every customer and you are sure to satisfy time windows. And also you know that you cannot have subtours because of these constraints. Because if you have a subtour, at some point the time will not be increasing, and that's not possible because of this constraint. Okay, so this is a standard compact formulation, which is not very efficient, probably, as you know. And you can propose a very different formulation, which is called the extended formulation, and based on this set, omega, that is composed of all the feasible routes that can be executed for the service. So an element of this set omega is exactly a route that can be performed by a vehicle, so that starts from the depot, visits some customers, and come back to the depot. This route has to be feasible, meaning that you respect capacity constraint, you respect time windows. So you can imagine that this set is possibly very large, but we will see how to handle it after. Then once you consider an element of this set, you can compute its cost, because you know exactly the root. So knowing the root, you know the arcs that are successively used in the root, and so you can compute the cost easily. And you can have this kind of information that indicate which customer are present into the root. So AIK is equal to 1 if the root visits some customer I, 0 otherwise. So with this notation, once you have this set, omega, you can reformulate the VRPTW with this extended formulation. So now the variable indicates the route that will be selected in the solution. So in the solution of the problem, you will select some route. It's just like if you have a catalog of routes, and you will say, okay, I'll take this route, and this route, and it will give me a solution. So you have to select some route, and you want to minimize the cost of the route that have been selected. So you sum the CK times theta k. So theta k is the variable that indicate if a route is selected or not, and ck is the cost of the route. You want to cover all the customers. So given a customer vi, you want to make sure that at least one route visits these customers. So this is given by this left-hand side term. And you have at most u routes. So sum of the theta k gives you the number of routes that have been selected, and this number cannot be greater than u. And that's all. And of course, the problem with this formulation is the size of omega. No, if you have many, many, many routes, you cannot really compute omega. And if you cannot compute omega, you cannot write this model into CPLEX or whatever you want. Just to illustrate the formulation on a simple example. So on this example, you have the depot and three customers, V1, V2, and V3. I'm going to use this customer after this example after to explain the method. So in this example, to simplify, I do not consider the capacity constraint. I consider that I have a capacity Q, so I don't care about the capacity, and the demand is 1 for each customer. I consider that the fleet is unlimited to simplify, which means that I will not have this constraint. The fleet is not limited. I don't have to limit the number of variables selected. Apart from that, what you can see here are the time windows. So the first customer has to be serviced exactly at time 1, the second at time 2, and the third at time 3. These are the distances, or the time, or the cost, as you want, between the different vertices. On this example, you can enumerate all the routes that belong to set omega, and you can see that you have 7 possible routes. So R1 is the one that visits only customer 1, R2 is the one that visits only customer 2, R3 visits only customer 3. Then you can visit V1 and V2 in this order. So you start at time 0, you arrive here at time 1, you serve V1, you arrive here at time 2, you serve V2, and you come back to V0, and it costs 3.4. You can visit V1 and V3 in this order. So in this case, you start at time 0, you arrive here at time 1, you arrive here at time 2.4, and you wait until time 3, and then you come back at time 4 at V0. You can visit V2 and V3 in this order, or V1, V2, and V3, and you don't have any other possibilities. For example, it's never possible to visit V3 before V2 or V1 because of the time windows. Then it means that you have 7 variables in your formulation, in your extended formulation. So one variable for each route. The objective is to minimize the sum of the cost of the route that are selected. So the number before each route variable here is the cost of the route. For example, I computed theta 4 was equal to 3.4, the cost of the route. And then the only constraint that you have is that you have to visit all the customers. So this one is for customer 1, this one is for customer 2, and this one is for customer 3. So if you look at customer 1, it is present in route 1, in route 4, in route 5, and in route 7, which means that you have to select at one of these four routes. So in other words, it means that the sum of the variable, theta 1 plus theta 4 plus theta 5 plus theta 7, has to be at least equal to 1. Then you are sure that you select one of the routes, so you are sure that customer 1 is visited. And the same for customer 2 and the same for customer 3. In this case, I give you the optimal solution. You can try to find it to make sure that it's optimal if you want. You can be confident. This is the optimal solution. The value is 4. And you only select route 7 that visits the three customers. Okay, so we have two formulations. We have a compact formulation. The advantage of the compact formulation is that you can use this formulation in Cplex. It's easy. You have a polynomial number of variables and constraints. So you can easily code that and try to solve it with a branch and bound. With the extended formulation, it's not possible because of the size of omega. So what could be the interest of the extended formulation? The interest is that the linear relaxation of this formulation is going to be much better than the linear relaxation of this one. I can just illustrate that on another simple example, an example that is even smaller than the one before. So in this case, you assume that you have two customers, V1 and V2, and again, time windows that are very tight. So you have to serve customer 1 at time 1 and customer 2 at time 2. I don't consider capacity constraint. I don't consider the limited number of vehicles. And this is a proposition, not necessarily the optimal solution, but a feasible solution for the compact formulation. So if you consider the compact formulation, the first one, if you consider the linear relaxation of this compact formulation, this is a feasible solution. So apparently it doesn't really look like a feasible solution, but you can check, it is a feasible solution. So in this solution, I have two vehicles, vehicle 1 and vehicle 2, with a flow 0.5. So the first vehicle goes from V1 to V2 and come back to V1. The second vehicle goes from V1 to V2 and come back to V1. And this is feasible. Why? If we look at all the constraints, first constraint, the outgoing flow has to be at least 1 for every customer. You can check. There's an outgoing flow of 1 from V1 and an outgoing flow of 1 from V2. So that's fine. These constraints are respected. Balance constraint, flow balance constraints are respected. No problem. Each vehicle leaves at most 1 the depot. Fine. Capacity constraints are satisfied, fine. These one apparently are not satisfied because we have subtours. But if you are more careful, you can see that in this one, the variable xigu is equal to 0.5, which means that the constraint is not active because you have the left-hand side with the good value variable s and so on. And on the right-hand side, it remains m minus m divided by 2. So it remains m divided by 2. M divided by 2 is a big number, so which means that the constraint is not active. So in this case, if you set the time of visit at 1 to V1 and at 2 to V2, here you have a small number, and this small number is less than m divided by 2, and so the constraint is satisfied. So with this formulation, even if you have subtour elimination constraint, because of the fractional value for the variable, the binary variables in the linear relaxation, the subtour elimination constraints are not very active, not very efficient, and you allow this kind of subtours, and so you can have some solution with a very small value. In this case, the value of the solution is 0.2. You have a flow 1 on this arc, a flow 1 on this arc. The cost of the arc is 0.1, so you have 0.1 plus 0.1, so it's 0.2. Now if I look at the same example, but with the extended formulation. So with this example, so it's the same, I can compute the set omega. You have three possible routes. The one that start at zero, visit customer one and come back to zero. The one that start at zero, visit customer two and come back to zero. And the one that visit zero, one, two, zero. So it corresponds to variables theta one, theta two, and theta three, with the cost 2, 2, and 2.1. Then the formulation, you have to visit customer one, so you have to select either route one or route three. You have to visit customer two, so you have to select either route two or route three. And this is the linear relaxation of this extended formulation. And if you solve it with Cplex, or if you solve it by hand, it's not that complicated, you can see that the optimal solution of this linear relaxation is this value. You will select variable theta 3 equal to 1 and the two other variables equal to 0. So you are solving the linear relaxation, but you obtain an integer solution, and you obtain the optimal integer solution of cost 2.1. So with this extended formulation, you can see that the linear relaxation is very good. You directly obtain solving, in this case, of course it's not always the case, but in this case, solving the linear relaxation, you obtain an integer solution and you obtain the optimal integer solution directly. So that's why you want to address your problem with this extended formulation. The problem is that you have to deal with the size of omega. And that's why you introduce column generation to solve this kind of problems using this kind of formulations. So just a few words about dancing wolf decomposition. When you hear about column generation or branch and price, you often hear about dancing wolf decomposition. So what is the relationship between dancing wolf decomposition and column generation? Actually, dancing wolf decomposition is a way to go from the compact formulation to the extended formulation. So if you apply dancing wolf decomposition to this formulation, you will obtain the extended formulation. So if you face a problem, a vehicle loading problem, or another type of problem that you want to solve exactly, you might choose between two possibilities. Either you can try to write the compact formulation and then apply dancing wolf decomposition method. You're going to write a lot of equations that not necessarily very easy, but at the end you should obtain an extended formulation. Or the second possibility is just to find by yourself the extended formulation, which generally is very simple. You have to select variable and you have to serve all the customers. And sometimes you have some additional constraints, but not a lot. So most extended formulations look like that. And so generally, you don't really need to apply dancing wolf decomposition. You have a problem, you are able to write directly this extended formulation, and you can claim that, okay, this is the extended formulation and it could be obtained applying dancing wolf decomposition from a compact formulation. But you do not always need to really perform this dancing wolf decomposition. However, it's very interesting to see that you have applied dancing wolf decomposition because it gives you some information on the quality of the linear relaxation. Actually, what's happening is that if you consider the compact formulation and the constraint that are in red here, this constraint defined a set of solution, a set of points. So here it's not the linear relaxation, it's the variable are integer, are binary here. So when you consider these binary variables and this constraint, you obtain a finite set of points. And these points are exactly vectors that start at most once from the depot, satisfy capacity constraints, satisfy time windows, satisfy flow balance constraint, which means that actually the points that you find here, another point is that all these constraints can be decomposed by U, the number of vehicles. So which means that a point that satisfies all these constraints is exactly a combination of routes for each vehicle. For each U, if you satisfy all these constraints, you are a feasible route. Satisfying this constraint is exactly the same as being a feasible route. So which means that the set of points that is here is exactly omega power u, the number of vehicles. And that's how dancing wolf decomposition works. It transforms the set of constraints into the set of points, and then using the set of points, you keep this constraint that tells you that you want to cover all the customers. You keep the objective function, but you replace this variable by combination of these points, and you obtain this this extended formulation. What you can try intuitively to see here is why this formulation is stronger. This formulation is stronger because you keep this structure when you apply the linear relaxation. When you consider the linear relaxation of the compact formulation, you lose the structure of roots. When you compute the linear relaxation of this extended formulation, this one is not relaxed. You keep integrality in this red part of the constraint. So that's why it's stronger. It's really intuitive, but maybe you can see that. The consequence, an important consequence, is that if the linear relaxation of this constraint is equal to the integer formulation, you have no interest in going to the extended formulation. So if you have the integrality property here, if, for example, this is a shortest path problem, if this is a shortest path problem, the linear relaxation will give you a path, an integer solution. You know that it has the integrality property. You know that you cannot obtain fractional optimal solution. The optimal solution of the linear relaxation will be integer. So if this constraint has the integrality property, then you're not going to improve the quality of the relaxation using the extended formulation. So in this case, you don't really need to use Coulomb generation, except if the size of this compact formulation is too large. Sometimes it happens. You have many, many, many arcs, many vehicles, so it's too large. You cannot really use a compact formulation. Then you can use Coulomb generation. But for vehicle routing problems, the main reason why you're going to use Coulomb generation is because these constraints do not have the integrality property. So you're going to improve a lot the linear relaxation when you use extended formulation. Okay, so we see that we want to use the extended formulation and we have to deal with the size of omega. And so now we will see how we can apply Coulomb generation to deal with this difficulty. And you can see the Sainte-Victoire mountain near Aix-en-Provence. That is also famous because it was painted by Paul Cézanne. And this is the kind of river that you have in Provence compared to here. Okay, so some vocabulary. We are going to introduce the master problem. The master problem is the linear relaxation of the extended formulation. So you consider the extended formulation, you relax integrality, and you obtain the linear relaxation, and that's called the master problem. The restricted master problem is the same, except that you consider that you don't have all the elements of omega, and so you restrict omega to a subset, omega t, omega 1 on the slide, no? Yes, omega t or omega 1. And so you consider only a subset of variables, and in this case, as you have a subset of variables, I don't know, for example, 100 or 1000 or something that is reasonable, then you can easily write the formulation into a software. This is a restricted master problem. So what you have to see is that the restricted master problem can be solved easily. This is your LP of reasonable size. So you can use CPLEX and solve the restricted master problem. And usually, you will have the optimal solution in a fraction of seconds. But the master problem cannot be solved easily because there are too many variables. So the aim of the column generation will be to solve this master problem, this MP. Again, something that is important to see is that with column generation, you only solve the linear relaxation. Column generation is a linear programming technique. You do not solve integer program with column generation. You solve linear programs. You need a branch and price to solve integer program. We will see that after. So for the time being, we only consider the linear relaxation, the master problem, and we want to solve this master problem. And so we use the fact that we are able to solve easily the restricting master problem. And so basically, column generation is like that. You start with an initial set of columns. We will say a few words about it after. Then you solve the restricted master problem by simplex method, for example, with simplex, if you want. Again, it's very quick. Once you have solved that, you have some dual information. We'll see that after. And we'll be able to determine if there are some roots that are not into the formulation, so that are in the variables that are not included into the formulation, if there are some roots that need to be added or not. If some roots need to be added, we are going to add the root to the set omega and iterate. So we'll have a set omega that is augmented with a new root. We solve again the linear relaxation, so the restricted master problem, sorry, with a simplex. And we will try to answer this question. And we continue like that for several iterations. And at some point, the answer to this question, a new root needs to be added, will be no. No, all the roots that are not in the formulation are not interesting. Then we will stop. That's exactly column generation. So the only difficulty, the main difficulty, is the one in yellow. How can we see if a new root needs to be added or not? Actually, I'm going to use Okay. So at that point, you just solved the restricted master problem. So when you solve the restricted master problem, you have these variables in omega t, and in these variables you have the basic variables, and you have the non-basic variables. And what you know, as you solved at optimality the restricted master problem, you know that the non-basic variables are equal to zero in the optimal solution and have a non-negative reduced cost. So this is the termination criterion of the simplex method. At the end, you know that the non-basic variables have a non-negative reduced cost, so it's not interesting to consider one of the variable and add it to the basis. So, and you know that this one can be equal to zero or positive, and they have a reduced cost equal to zero. Okay, now, so we just solved the restricted master problem and we have this information. And now we have some variables that are not in the formulation. And the question is, do we have in this set variables with negative reduced cost. Because if we don't have variables with negative reduced cost, then we can consider that all these variables are equal to zero and have a non-negative reduced cost. So if all these variables have a non-negative reduced cost, if we consider that it's just like if they were already in the formulation but equal to zero, they have a non-negative reduced cost, and so the termination criteria of the simplex method applies, and we know that we exactly have the optimal solution of the problem with all these variables present. So you can really imagine column generation as it's really the same as the simplex method. At some iteration, I have stopped my simplex algorithm with some bases. So I have these basic variables. These one are equal to zero. These one were not considered because they are not in the formulation. But implicitly, I can consider them and see, okay, these variables that are not in my model, maybe some of them have a negative reduced cost. If they have a negative reduced cost, it means that if I add them to the model, they will be introduced into the basis. If they don't have a negative reduced cost, it means that if I add them to the model, they will stay non-basic because they have a non-negative reduced cost, and so they satisfy the termination criteria and they are not interesting to enter into the basis. So column generation will exactly try to answer this question. In the remaining variables, in this one, the one that are not in the restricted master problem and that were not considered when applying the simplex algorithm on the restricted master problem, in these variables, do I have some variables with a negative reduced cost? If I have variables with a negative reduced cost, they are candidates to improve the quality of the solution, and I have to introduce them into my model. So this is a yes branch on the slide. If all the variables here have a non-negative reduced cost, it means that there is no potential to improve the solution, and I can stop because I have the optimal solution considering this whole set of variables. Okay, so this is a step ahead. Now we know that this is what we have to check. And so if we are naive, what we might do is to consider set omega and just evaluate the value of every member of set omega, so the reduced cost, check every value and see if there are some elements with a negative reduced cost. But of course, again, set omega is very large, and so it's very difficult and long to do that. So we have to find another way to be able to answer this question: do we have some columns or some variables with negative reduced cost without enumerating set omega? Okay, we will see how we can do that, but first I'm going to give you some more details on the reduced cost. So if you know the theory of linear programming, you can know that given this linear program, you have these dual variables. So one dual variable with each constraint. So lambda I is a dual variable associated with the covering of customers, customer I. And lambda zero is a dual variable that corresponds to the constraint that limits the fleet size. So these one are non-negative, and this one are non-positive. This one is non-positive. And then, so you can apply standard formula to know that the reduced cost of a variable is this value, the cost of the root. So a variable corresponds to a root. The reduced cost is the cost of the root on which you subtract lambda zero, but actually lambda zero is non-positive, so you add something. And each time you visit a customer, you subtract the dual price lambda I. So more or less, if you consider the root, you start the root with the value ck minus lambda zero. So this is some kind of fixed cost for the route. And then each time you visit a customer, you subtract lambda I. And if it at the end, if it's negative at the end, it means that your route should be introduced into your formulation. Otherwise, it's not interesting. Okay, so we talk about colon generation, and we don't really know what is a colon. So actually, a colon is exactly a variable and is exactly a route. It's the same thing. So I'm going to use indifferently the three terms. Why is it the case? Because a colon, if you consider this formulation as a matrix, a variable is a colon of the matrix, and a variable represents a root. So that's why it's called colon generation. You start with a small matrix, and you will have new colons into the matrix progressively. An important remark is that you are sure that a colon cannot be added several times to your formulation. Once a colon is in the formulation, if a colon, so if a variable is in omega t, then at the end of the simplex algorithm, your colon is either a basic variable or a non-basic variable, but in all cases, it has a non-negative reduced cost, so equal to zero or positive. So you are sure that the colons that are already present in the formulation do not have a negative reduced cost. So you are sure that you're not going to reintroduce a colon that is already present into the formulation. And as the number of colons is finite, you are sure that the algorithm is finite. At worst, you will add all the colons one by one, but at some point you will finish because you will have added all the colons and you are sure that you are not going to reintroduce some colons that are already present in the new formulation. When you implement colon generation, it often happens that some colons are added several times, which means that you have a bug somewhere. So theoretically, it's not possible. So if it happens, there's something that is wrong somewhere. Okay, so now we are going to illustrate that on a simple example. I take time because I want you to understand quite well what we are doing. So again, the same example, this one with the three customers. The master problem, the restricted master problem here. So I decided to initialize the colon generation here with this initial set with three routes. Remember that on this example we had seven routes. So I have taken three of these seven routes and it initialized the algorithm. These three routes are the ones that exactly visit one customer, start from the depot, visit one customer and come back to the depot. So R1 for customer 1, R2 for customer 2, R3 for customer 3. So the master problems looks like that. You have three variables with these three constraints. Every customer has to be served. So the only way to serve customer 1 is to use route 1 and so on. We are considering the linear relaxation, so the variables are continuous, they are not integral. And you can easily see that the optimal solution of this LP is to set the three variables to 1, and the cost is 6.8. You cannot do better. So the linear relaxation here is 6.8. At the same time, if you solve with the simplex algorithm this LP, you will have the optimal dual solution. For example, this is this value. To be convinced that this is a dual solution, I have written here the dual program. So this is a primal. The dual program that corresponds to this primal is here. So with the three variables, lambda 1, lambda 2, and lambda 3 that correspond to these three constraints. Lambda 0 is not present because I don't have the fleet size constraint. And so you are used to dual formulation, you can see that you have to transpose this matrix. You have to take this vector and put this vector here, and this vector here appears in the objective function. So this is a dual. You want to maximize, the sum of these three dual variables. You are limited by these three values, and again it's very easy to see that the maximum value is 2 plus 2.8 plus 2. The sum is 6.8 and is the same as the value of the optimal primal solution, which is the duality theorem. Okay, so now if you consider the scheme, we have an initial set composed of three variables. We have solved with the simplex method the restricted master problem, and now we want to find if there are some roots with negative reduced cost. For the time being, we don't know how to find this root, so I'm going just to say you, okay, check root 4, and you will see that root 4 has a negative reduced cost. After, we will see how to find this root, but for the time, for now, I just exhibit root 4. So if you look at root 4, the cost of the root is 3.4, so root 4 visits 0, 1, 2, 0, so the cost is 1 plus 1 plus 1.4, so 3.4. The dual value of customer 1 is 2, the dual value of customer 2 is 2.8, so 3.4 minus 2 minus 2.8 is equal to minus 1.4, which is negative, which means that this root could help decreasing the value of the optimal solution, and so we are going to add this variable into the formulation. And this is the next iteration. We have added this variable to the formulation, so we have a new variable in the formulation and in the set. This variable is theta 4 with a cost 3.4. It serves customer 1, customer 2. And so this is the new restricted master problem with a new variable. If you look at the dual, when you add a variable in the master problem, you add a constraint in the dual problem, in the dual formulation, and this constraint is this one. You have the two customers that are present in the root, lambda 1 plus lambda 2, that has to be less than or equal to 3.4. Just an important remark here, again, you can see that satisfying the dual constraint is exactly the same as having a non-negative reduced cost. This constraint is more or less the reduced cost. The reduced cost was 3.4 minus lambda 1 minus lambda 2. And so this constraint was violated. 3.4 minus lambda 1 minus lambda 2 was negative. And so adding the variable into the formulation is equivalent to adding this constraint, this dual constraint into the formulation, and it explicitly imposes that the reduced cost of the wood is non-negative. So now we are sure that this wood cannot have a negative reduced cost because of this constraint, this dual constraint. So if we continue, so we have a new restricted master problem. We solve it with the simplex method, and let's be confident that the optimal solution costs 5.4. So if you try, you will see that it's true. You have two variables in the solution. Variable theta 4 is equal to 1, and variable theta 3 is equal to 1. So you visit customer 3 with root 3, and customer 1 and 2 with root 4. The cost is 5.4 because the cost of this root is 3.4 and this one is 2, so the total is 5.4. And you can find an optimal dual solution also that is given by the simplex method, and for example this one, you can check that all the constraints are satisfied. The first one is satisfied, the second one is satisfied, the third one is satisfied, and the last one is also satisfied. So all the constraints are satisfied, this is feasible, the cost is 5.4, so both primal and dual solution have the same value, they are both optimals. Okay, so again, I have to try to answer my question, do I have some roots that are not in my formulation and that have a negative reduced cost? And again, I just exhibit such root, just look at root 7. And if you look at root 7, you will see that it has a negative reduced cost. So root 7 is the one that visits all the three customers. The cost of the root is 4. If you subtract all the dual variables, so the one of customer 1, customer 2, and customer 3. This is negative. So you will have to add this variable to the formulation, or to the set omega. So at the next iteration, you have now a set omega with 5 elements. Now you have this variable that has been added. It serves customer 1, 2, and 3, so it appears in the three constraints. You have this new dual constraint that has appeared, that basically tells you that now the reduced cost of the root has to be non-negative. And you can solve it again with the simplex method. You solve it with the simplex method, and you obtain a solution with a cost 4 that only selects root 7. You have a dual solution, 1, 2, 1. You can check. It satisfies all the constraints. So just look at that. You will see that all the constraints are satisfied. And so these primal and dual solutions are optimal for the restricted master problem. And now you can check all the remaining roots. So I can write it here. It remains two roots. So the root so this one, if you look at the reduced cost of this one, it's 3.4, which is the cost of the root, minus the dual variable of customer 1, minus the dual variable of customer 3, 1, which is positive. So this root does not have a negative reduced cost. The other one that is missing is this one. So if you check for this one, again, the cost is 3.4 minus the dual variable for vertex 2, it's 2 minus 1, again, it's positive. So you can see that all the roots that are not included in the formulation are have a positive reduced cost, which also means that you have the optimal solution of the master problem. The dual constraints are satisfied for this root, so your solution is dual feasible for the master, for the complete formulation, and so you know that it's optimal. Okay, so of course, for the time being, I'm cheating because I have just enumerated all the roots and checked that they all have a positive reduced cost. The next step will be to automate that and to be able to answer this question, do I have some roots with a negative reduced cost without enumerating like that. Is it clear? Do we have, maybe if you have some question, I can answer, yes?
Why when you compute the reduced cost, you are not considering lambda 0?
Okay, because in this case, I have considered that the fleet size was infinite. So I have as many vehicles as I want in this example, to simplify, to avoid having lambda 0 in my formulation. So I just relaxed the constraint on the fleet size. So I don't have this constraint, I don't have the dual variable. So just to simplify the example. Otherwise, it will be exactly the same, but with lambda 0 in addition to what I have written.
So in a problem with unlimited capacity or unlimited number of vehicles, you will always have the linear relaxation from the master problem will be exactly as the integer solution?
Always an integer solution?
Uh-huh.
No.
Because as I see the formulation, I mean the master problem, it is not possible to combine two different routes, unless they both have the same nodes, you know?
No, when you consider large instances, it is possible that the optimal solution of this linear of the master problem or this linear relaxation are not integer. In this case, it's very a small problem, a small size, and so most of the time you will have an integer solution when you solve the LP. But in the general case, it's possible that the optimal solution is fractional. It's not that easy to build an example, a small example that is fractional, but it's possible. So you. No, they are positive, yes, non-negative. Other questions, no? Yes?
You said that one column is generated only once. Is that meaning that once it's left, we can know the basic elements
of the basis? No. Once it is in a set, in the restricted set, omega t, then it will not be reintroduced into this set. But into this set, at some iteration it will be in the basis, and at some iteration it will not be in the basis, it depends. Yes? Yes, yes. 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 Yes and no. For the time being, no. But you can imagine to do that. I will discuss about it after, if I have time. I'm supposed to stop at 5:30. No. At cinq heures, c'était fini là, non? J'ai commencé à 4h30. À 4h, j'ai commencé à 4h. Et j'avais 1h30. Donc j'avais jusqu'à 5h30. J'avais jusqu'à 5h30. Et comme on a du retard, et qu'on n'a pas besoin de pause, j'ai jusqu'à 6h. Ok. Okay, so okay, so I have already said that. Just for the one that know this algorithm, probably not a lot of people know it. I just tell it because I have seen that, but I don't really know this algorithm neither. So if you consider the dual, when you apply current generation, it looks like that. You have MP. That has a dual polyhedron that is composed of a lot of constraints. So you have one constraint for each variable in the master problem. So if you have, don't know, billions of variables, you have billions of constraints in the dual formulation. And so you have all these constraints. And what you are doing is to start with a limited subset of constraints. So if you look at the dual at first, for example, in my example, I have only three constraints because I had three primal variables. So then I have added one constraint, then another one, and so on. So from iteration to iteration, you add some constraint. So you start with a very bad approximation of your dual space with a few constraints. Then you solve to optimality your LP on this dual space, so the one that is this polyhedron, this one. You obtain some dual solution, dual optimal solution, and then you have your famous question, this one, that tells you, okay, I'm not dual feasible, this is the same, is there a negative colon with negative reduced cost, it means I am dual feasible or not. So you see that you are not dual feasible. And as you are not dual feasible, you add a constraint, a dual constraint, that removes this point, and you continue like that. And this is exactly what is doing the Kelly's algorithm for convex nonlinear programming. So if you have to solve a convex nonlinear program, you can address it like that. You start with some approximation of the convex feasible set, and then you generate new cuts until you find a feasible solution. At some point, after having generated a lot of cuts, you will find the feasible solution. And once you find the feasible solution, you know that it's optimal. So that's Kelly algorithm, and that's exactly what is done with column generation, if you look at what's happening with a dual point of view. Okay, so now it's about implementation. If you want to implement column generation, at first sight, you might think that, okay, if I introduce the optimal columns, or the good columns, or the good woods from the beginning, it will be very fast. It's not necessarily true. Just look at that example. Assume that I consider the same example as before, but I initialize my set, my restricted set, with the optimal solution. In my case, the optimal solution was this root, R7. I have seen that, if I come back, this was the optimal solution. I only select root 7. So I initialize my set omega with root 7, and if I might think that, okay, I have already the optimal root, so when I will solve with a simplex algorithm my restricting my master problem, it will tell me, okay, you already have the good root, all the other one is bad, so it's finished. And it's not going to happen like that. When you solve the problem with this single root, so the master problem is like that and the dual problem is like that, and you might obtain, for example, this optimal dual solution. So the optimal primal solution is this one. You only select root 7. The cost is 4. So you already have the cost of the optimal solution. The primal solution is optimal, actually, but you don't know it. And the dual variable, the dual solution is this one, for example, 0, no, 4, 0, 0. You can see that it satisfies the single dual constraint that you have. You need that the sum is less than or equal to 4. So for example, this one satisfies the constraint. And if you look at root R1, for example, root R1 has a cost 2 minus the dual value of customer 1, so 2 minus 4. So the reduced cost is minus 2. It's negative. So it means that you can opt to improve the linear, the value of the restricted master problem by adding this colon to the formulation. So you will have to add the colon to the formulation. And of course, what you will observe is that it does not allow you to decrease the quality of the solution. You still have a solution, optimal solution of cost 4, looking at the primal. But then you will have this, for example, this dual variable, 0 for 0, that is optimal. Again, you can check. Now lambda 1 is not able to be equal to 4 because you added this constraint, but lambda 2 is able to be equal to 4. So for example, you will obtain this optimal dual solution, and again root v0, v2, v0 this time has a negative reduced cost, so you will have to add this root to the formulation and so on, and you will need to add a lot of roots before arriving to the situation where all the roots have a non-negative reduced cost. So that's the problem of convergence, also the problem of stabilization. You are only able to conclude that it's optimum when you have a good estimation of the dual variables. And to have a good estimation of the dual variables, you need many columns. If you have only one column, you had a very bad estimation of dual variables. Because when you start here, you can have optimal solution 4, 0, 0, or 0 for 0, or 0, 0, 4, or 1, 1, 2, or 2, 1, 1, and so on and so on. You have many, many, many optimal dual solutions that are equivalent. They have the same cost, but they are very different, and you're not stabilized. So you have to generate a lot of columns to converge toward the optimal dual solution. So you have the optimal primal solution, but you're not able to prove that it's optimal. And to be able to prove that it's optimal, you will have to generate a lot of columns. So that's something that is quite important. If you want to use column generation to prove as an exact method to find the optimal solution, you don't really care about the initialization. What is important is the last iteration. You want to conclude at some point that you have no column with negative reduced cost. And the initialization is not the complicated part. You don't really need to take a lot of time to try to find good columns with heuristics or things like that. Okay, so just exactly what I said. In terms of efficiency, you try to find a good initial set of columns to limit oscillation of dual variables, but that's not really the main point of the method. It doesn't have a strong impact. Typically, what you will do is to apply a simple heuristic and initialize the method with a simple solution. For example, you apply savings algorithm and you initialize the method with the columns obtained with the savings algorithm. Or you just introduce a back and forth route that go to the depot, visit one customer and come back, and you just start the method with this route. And usually that's enough. You don't really need to care much about that. Okay, there's however an important point here is that here in the column generation scheme, you need to solve this one by simplex and then to evaluate negative reduced cost. But what's happening if when you solve the restricted master problem, you don't have a feasible solution? No, you solve a linear program and sometimes a linear program doesn't have any feasible solution. And if you don't have a feasible solution, you cannot continue because you don't have dual variables, you don't have a point to which you can rely to compute negative reduced cost. So you absolutely need to have a feasible solution for your restricted master problem. And if you consider the VRPTW, for example, this is the problem that we are dealing with now, finding a feasible solution for the VRPTW is NP-hard. So it's not necessarily easy to have this feasible solution. In this case, what you have to do is to introduce artificial variables. So in your formulation, you can introduce an artificial variables that you can more or less imagine as subcontracting some service. For example, you can say that, okay, I'm allowed not to serve some customers, but with a large price. If I don't serve a customer, so I have a variable, ZI, for example, that is binary or positive in the linear relaxation. And if this variable is equal to 1, the customer is served. So the variable will appear in this constraint. For example, here you will have Z1 saying that, okay, theta 7 plus theta 1 plus Z1 has to be greater than or equal to 1. So you have either to serve the customers with the standard route, 7 and 1, or to subcontract. So someone will do it for me. But then the cost of Z1 in the objective function is very large. But Z1 will not appear in this constraint. So I have my fleet of limited size, but here the customers that are not served by my vehicles are not considered. The vehicles that I only consider my vehicles here. So I know that the solution where all customers are subcontracted is feasible. It's very costly, but it's feasible. So I'm sure to have a feasible solution. As soon as I'm sure to have a feasible solution, I can apply the method because I will solve the linear program, the restricted linear program. I will obtain some dual variables and I will be able to compute reduced cost, to find columns with negative reduced cost. And after some iteration, I will finally obtain a feasible solution. It might need time, I don't know, but I'm sure to converge to a feasible solution if it exists. Just that I have to introduce these artificial variables. So as I said, you can, this is exactly what I explained, you can propose high-cost routes that visit exactly one customer and that do not appear in the fleet size constraint. So in this case, you have n artificial variables. Or another possibility, but you have plenty of possibilities, just as you want, another possibility would be to have a single route that visits all the customers. So again, this is very, this route will be paid with a very high cost in the objective function. And you know that if you select this route, it's feasible, all the customers are served, so you know that you have a feasible solution. Okay, so that's something that you have to care when you are not sure to have a feasible solution. Something important in terms of efficiency, in the scheme that I presented, I say, okay, I find a column with negative reduced cost, I add this column to the formulation and I iterate. Actually, in an efficient implementation, I'm not going to add only one column at a time. At a given iteration, I might add 100 columns or something like that. So when I will try to find columns of negative reduced cost, I will be able to find many columns of negative reduced cost, and I will add, I'm going to add all these columns or many of these columns to the formulation at the same iterations. So I will start with 10 columns. Then after one iteration, I will have 50 columns, and then the next iteration, 100 columns, and so on. And so I will add many, many columns to limit the number of iterations. So that's very important. If you have in these vehicle routing problems, if you only add one column at each iteration, it's going to be very long. The risk is that you might add too many columns. In vehicle routing problems, honestly, you don't care. The number of columns in vehicle routing problems, the number of columns is generally not important. Because the size of the linear program that you will have to solve will always be very limited. Something like a few thousand variables. And a few thousand variables will be very fast compared to the method that you will use to find columns of negative reduced cost. So I should say that this is a pricing problem. The pricing problem is the one that helps you to find columns of negative reduced cost. This pricing problem is very costly in terms of time, of computing time. So you will spend a lot of time to find new columns, but the time that you will spend to solve LP is very small. So usually, you don't care, you add columns to your LP, and it's never a problem. But in case you are dealing with a problem where you have too many columns, you can just remove some of these columns at some point. For example, if you have 100,000 columns, you say, okay, I just take half of these columns, so 50,000 columns, the one with the larger reduced cost, I remove them from the formulation and I continue. You can do this kind of things to accelerate the method if you want. But usually, again, for vehicle routing problems, you don't have to do that. And finally, you have to take care of a numerical precision. Because when you solve this linear program, you often find columns that have a reduced cost equal to zero, but CPLEX gives you a reduced cost equal to minus 0.0000001. And so you say, okay, I found a column of negative reduced cost. I add this column to my model, and you're going to cycle, to repeat adding the same column, because numerically it's negative, but in practice it's equal to zero. So you have to when you say, do I have a column of negative reduced cost, you have to introduce some small constant value like that, and say, do you have columns that are less than this number? And then you avoid this numerical effect. So you have to be careful with that, otherwise you meet some problems. Okay, so the pricing problem. So the pricing problem is this one, in yellow. We have seen more or less everything in the schemes. We start with an initial set. We have said that it's not so important. We are able to solve with simplex, no problem. We rely on simplex for that. we have this pricing problem that we have to clarify. We know that we are going to add several colons at a time, not only one, as it's explained here. And otherwise, we stop. So everything is quite clear. It's supposed to be quite clear, except this part. How are we able to detect colons of negative reduced cost? As I said, a naive possibility would be to try to enumerate all the elements of omega and compute the value of each element and see if some have a negative reduced cost. Another way to address that is to say, okay, finally, this is a combinatorial optimization problem. I have a finite set of elements, omega. All these elements have a value, the reduced cost, and I search elements with a negative reduced cost, or I might also say that I search elements with the minimal value for the reduced cost. So I have a finite set of elements, each one has a value, and I search for the element with the minimal value. If the minimal value is negative, I have a colon with negative reduced cost. If the minimal value is non-negative, I know that they all are non-negative and it's finished. So I can express this as a combinatorial optimization problem, and to solve a combinatorial optimization problem, I can apply methods that are not simply enumerating all the elements of omega and trying to find which one are negative. So I'm going to address that as a combinatorial optimization problem, and actually to do that, I can see that the reduced cost can be expressed as a cost on arcs. So let me explain that. So this is my formula with seca, which is the cost of the root, and I subtract lambda I each time I visit a customer. So which means if I look at my root, each time I use an arc, I'm going to pay CIG, the cost of the arc, and at the end, the sum of the cost of the arc will give me CK, the cost of the root. And each time I visit a vertex, I will subtract lambda zero for the first one, for the initial depot, and lambda I each time I visit a vertex. And if I apply that rule, the cost that I have at the end is exactly the reduced cost. What I can do is to transfer these values from the vertex to the next arc. So if I do that, I modify arc costs. So now the cost of an arc is not CIG, but it's CIG minus lambda I. And then my reduced cost is exactly the cost of the path with these modified costs. And so what I'm searching for is the shortest path. If I modify arc cost like that, I'm searching for the shortest path to go from 0 to 0 in my graph. And I know I have methods to find shortest paths. The difficulty here is that it's not a simple shortest path. I have three constraints to consider with my shortest path. First, I have to make sure that time windows are satisfied. Second, I have to make sure that capacity constraints are satisfied. Third, I have to make sure that I only visit once each customer. Why do I have to make sure that I only visit once each customer? Because assume that I visit two times customer VI. It will mean that I will gain two times the lambda variable lambda 1. So I'm going to subtract two times this dual variable. And if I do that, I have a bad evaluation of my reduced cost, because in my reduced cost, I only subtract once this value. So when I compute my path, I have to make sure that I visit only once each customer. So I have to satisfy time windows, satisfy capacity constraint, and satisfy elementarity constraint, meaning that I only visit once, at most once, each customer. And this is what is called an elementary shortest path problem with resource constraints. So this is a problem that you can solve. There are some algorithms to solve it, but it's a problem that is NP-hard. It's not a shortest path problem that is polynomial, and there is a complexity to solve this problem. And that's why I said 10 minutes ago, that you're going to spend a lot of time when solving the pricing problem compared to the solution of the LP. So it's really here that you have to be efficient to avoid that the method is too long. Okay. I have to accelerate. So finally, we have the complete scheme. This is column generation. The pricing problem is to solve the elementary shortest path problem with a resource constraint. If we find a path with a negative cost in this modified cost structure, we add it to the formulation, otherwise we stop. How can we so we are 2 days from the finals, just a reminder. Solution of the elementary shortest path problem. I'm going to go very quickly. You probably know Bellman algorithm, so dynamic programming algorithm to solve shortest path. In this case, it's exactly the same, except that you will have multiple labels instead of having single labels at each node. So you consider your graph, so it's always the same instance. You initialize the method with a single label. A label is composed of different values. This one is the cost of the label, so it's zero for the time being. So it's a path that is at the depot and nothing has been done, so the cost is still zero. I'm going to extend this path. Zero is the time, the second value is the time. And the three values, the three remaining value indicates if V1, V2, and V3 can be reached or not. When it's equal to zero, it means that I can reach vertices V1, V2, and V3. And what I'm going to do is to extend the labels repeatedly. So this label, I extend it to the three possible directions. I obtain three new labels. So I'm just going to detail this one. So when I extend through this arc, the cost was zero. I added a cost 1 because the cost of the arc is 1, but I removed 2 because the dual variable of customer 1 is 2. So at the end, the cost is minus 1. Time is 1 because I can start the service at time 1. And I have visited vertex 1, so it's not possible to visit anymore vertex 1. And just this one again. So the cost is 1.4 minus the dual variable of vertex 2, so minus 2.8. So it's minus 1.4. Time is 2 because I arrive here at time 1.4 and I wait until the opening of the time window. So time is 2. And I visited vertex 2, so there's 1 here. But also I cannot reach anymore vertex 1 because it's the time window is closed. So I can say that it's not possible to visit vertex 1, so I have 1 here. And so on. So I have three labels in my memory, and I have to extend these three labels. So for example, I extend this one in all possible directions, and the algorithms continue like that. And you have some dominance rule that allows killing or removing some labels. In this case, this label is better than this one. Why? Because the reduced cost is smaller, the time is the same, and the customers that I can still reach are the same. So this one is more efficient. I can remove the other one. So thanks to this dominance rule, the combinatorial explosion will not be that important, and I will enumerate, extend all the labels like that, and after some times, I will have extended all the labels and it will be finished and I will have the path with a negative reduced cost. In this case, I already have one here, but the cost is positive. The cost is zero, it's not negative. Okay, so in the remaining 10 minutes, I will discuss about branch and price. So now we are able to solve the column generation, but again, column generation only solved the linear relaxation. We want to solve an integer problem. So we are going to apply branch and bound, as usual. But When we will apply branch and bound, at each node of the branch and bound tree, we will have to compute a linear relaxation, a lower bound, and this lower bound will be given by column generation, except of being given, as usual, by the simplex method. So it's a variant of branch and bound where you have this additional effort to do at each node to compute the lower bound, and that's why it's called branch and price. But branch and price is branch and bound. There's absolutely no difference. You can really say that it's branch and bound. It's just the way to compute the bound that is not standard. To compute the bound, you apply column generation. Okay, so when you apply branch and bound, usually what you do is you select a fractional variable and you branch. For example, you have a variable that is equal to 0.5 and you create two branches, one with a variable equal to 0 and one with the variable equal to 1. This is what you will do usually with a standard implementation of branch and bound. In this case, it's not going to be efficient. We will see why. So first, just look at this first node. In this node, you say that this route is forbidden. You're not allowed to select this route. So in the master problem, it's quite easy. You fix the variable to 0, or you remove the variables, and it's not allowed. In the pricing problem, now it's more complicated because you want to apply this dynamic programming scheme. Try to find if there are some variables with negative reduced cost, but you don't want to consider this route. Because this route, probably you can see that it has a negative reduced cost, the one that you have removed. And you want to be able to say, okay, I want to see if, except for this route, there is another route with a negative reduced cost. And this except for this route is very difficult to handle in the dynamic programming algorithm because of the dominance. Maybe this route will dominate other routes that have a negative reduced cost. But once they are dominated, they disappear. And so at the end, you don't know if they exist or not. So it's quite complicated. There are some techniques that exist, but it's quite complicated. So if you try to forbid some routes, you will have difficulties with the pricing problem. This case is very easy. If you force a route, say, okay, theta k is equal to 1, which means that I fix a route, then what you have is a smaller problem to solve. You fixed a route, so you have one vehicle that is already finished, you have decided what to do with this vehicle, you have some customers that I served, and you have a residual instance with one vehicle less, with some customer less, and you just continue applying the method on the residual instance. So it's very easy. In the master problem, you remove all the columns that visit the customers that are already served by this route, and in the pricing problem, you remove all these customers, and you continue with the residual instance. You don't consider anymore the customers that are already served. So this is not a difficulty. The difficulty is on this side. Also, and probably most importantly, this is completely unbalanced. Here you have a very strong decision. For example, you have decided to fix a route that visits 15 customers, maybe. So you really took a very important decision. On the left side, you have just removed one route among billions of routes. So it's very, very, very weak. So it's completely unbalanced. And so it's not going to be efficient. So what is done in practice is that you will branch by selecting an arc with a fractional flow. What do I mean by that? Is that when you have your solution, you can represent your solution on the graph, and you can compute the flow on each arc by summing the value of the paths that use these arcs. If you obtain an arc with a fractional flow, then you can select this arc and branch on this arc. On the first node, you will say, okay, this arc is not allowed anymore. I forbid using this arc. So this arc, just as if this road is, the road is, is cut, my vehicle cannot use this road. And on the other node, I will impose to use this arc, meaning that when I visit customer I have no choice, I have to go to customer G. An important point is that you can prove that if your solution of the restricted master problem is fractional, there exists an arc with a fractional flow. In other words, if all the arcs have an integer flow, your solution is integer. You have no choice. So if your solution is integer, you don't have to branch. So if you have to branch, it's always possible to use this branching scheme because you will always be able to find an arc with a fractional flow. Now, how you can deal with this branching in the master problem and the pricing problem? In the master problem, you forbid to use an arc, which means that you will fix to zero all the columns that use this arc in the master problem. So you have variables, you have roots that use this arc. These roots, the variables are set to zero, so it's not possible to use the arc. And you are sure that the solution that you will find does not use this arc. In the pricing problem, you don't want to generate columns that use this arc. You simply remove the arc from the graph. So when you search for the shortest path, you simply do not use this arc. So you're not going to extend label with this arc. That's all. That's very easy. Second node, you want to impose an arc. Imposing arc IG is exactly the same as forbidding arcs IK with K, IK with K not equal to G, and forbidding arc KG with K not equal to I. So it's exactly the same, you can just remove some arcs. You remove columns that use these arcs here in the master problem, you remove these arcs in the pricing problems. So it's very easy. And it gives you a branching scheme, and you can solve your vehicle routing problem with time windows with branch and price. So that's it. More generally, what is admitted is that when you apply branch and price, you're going to branch on the variables of the compact formulation. So that's how it's said usually. You have a compact formulation, you have an extended formulation. Maybe you don't even write the compact formulation because you prefer directly to write the extended formulation. But you have to be aware that there was a compact formulation, that the variables of this compact formulation looked like that. In this case, these are flow variables. And usually, you're going to branch on these flow variables. Sometimes, it's not possible and you have to add new constraints in the master problem when branching. In this case, when you branch and that you have new constraints in the master problem, it means that you have new dual variables, and you will have to consider these dual variables in the pricing problems to evaluate reduced cost. Sometimes it's easy, sometimes it's complicated. Also, what can be useful is to branch on the number of vehicles. If you use, 4.5 vehicles in your fractional solution, you can say, okay, I use at most 4 vehicles or at least 5. It's a strong decision and often it's useful to do that, to start branching on the number of vehicles. Okay, to conclude, how many time do I have? 2 minutes? 2 minutes, okay. So the conclusion will be quick. Okay, so in a few words, the extended formulation gives a far better lower bound than the compact formulation. So that's why we go into column generation and branch and price. Because if you think about it, when you apply branch and price, you have a branch and bound tree. At each node of the branching tree, you have to apply in column generation. At each iteration of column generation, you have to solve the pricing problem. And the pricing problem is NPR'd. So we'll have to solve hundreds of times an NPR'd problem to solve your VRPTW. So it looks strange, but at the end, it can be efficient if the implementation is good. But you're going to solve a lot of NPR'd problems. Something important that I have to say, most of the time, you're not going to solve exactly this NPR problem. As soon as you have a column of negative reduced cost, you can stop. You don't really need the optimal negative reduced cost. You just need to find columns with negative reduced cost. So as soon as you have found some column with negative reduced cost, you can stop. So it avoids solving exactly all these NPR problems. You only have to solve exactly these NPR problems for the last iteration, when it's difficult to find columns of negative reduced cost, and you really have to go to the end of the solution algorithm to prove, either to find a column of negative reduced cost or to prove that it doesn't exist. This is very generic. All the specific constraints of the vehicle loading problem are in the pricing problem. If you have, many compartments, some driver constraints, some strange constraints, it's all in the pricing problem. It's all when you compute the feasible routes. So all the method is very generic. Just in the 10 seconds that remain, two words that you have to know. NG-Woods. NG-Woods, it's a way to accelerate the solution of the pricing problem. You partially allow to visit several times some customers. So it's a quickly answer to the question that was asked a few minutes ago. Sometimes you will allow to visit again some customers. It deteriorates slightly the relaxation, but it accelerates a lot the solution of the pricing problem. So it was proposed more or less recently, and there is really a stream of research about how to accelerate the pricing problem. And usually you're not going to search only elementary route. You will accept some non-elementary routes. There's a lot of papers about that. Second important point and last point, it's about improving the quality of the relaxation. Even if the relaxation is good, you can still try to improve it to be even better. Because if you improve the quality of the relaxation, you limit the number of nodes in the branch and bound tree, and so you limit the number of times you will have to solve the pricing problem. And some inequalities prove to be very useful. These are the subset inequalities that I don't have time to explain. You will see on the slide. It's easy. The problem with these inequalities is that you add new valid inequalities in your formulation, and when you add new valid inequalities in the formulation, you add new dual variables, so you have to consider the dual variables in the pricing problem, and it can complicate the solution of the pricing problem. And in this case, the subset row inequalities really complicate the solution of the pricing problem. They are very efficient, but they complicate the pricing problem. Okay, some references. Thank you.
So we have just time maybe for one question, because next we have to solve a routing problem from this location to the break with the time windows. So one question, yes?
Thank you for this presentation. I have a question regarding the reduction of the pricing problem to a short path problem. Does it generalize to every problem, or is it special for this VRP problem? And I have also a question maybe at the border of this presentation regarding the relationship between column generation and constraint generation. Is it always equivalent?
Okay, so for the first question, for vehicle routing problems, yes, the pricing problem is always some kind of shortest path problem with some additional constraints, so some resource constraints. Depending on the type of vehicle routing problem that you have, you won't have the same resource definition. So you will have more or less resources, and it will be more or less easy to solve. If you consider other kind of problems, for example, machine scheduling problems, you can apply column generation, and the pricing problem will be different. For example, it might be NACSAP problems or things like that. But in the cases when your pricing problem has a polynomial complexity, you are not going to improve the quality of the relaxation. So you might want to apply column generation because you have too many variables, as I said, but it's not going to help you improving the quality of the regression. But yes, I really focused on vehicle routing problems. It's not the same for other types of problems. For the second question, yes, you can consider that column generation is constraint generation or cut generation at the level of the dual program, because when you add columns, you add cut for the dual. But branch and price is not branch and cut, it's different. Usually, in the literature, people address this method with the primal point of view. So you really generate columns, you don't generate cuts. Even if you might consider that you generate cuts for the dual, but when you, in the intuition that people have when they develop this method, they generate variables, they generate columns, new routes. I don't know if it really answers the question, but.
I propose we stop and that you take advantage of the break to speak with Dominique. Before the break, thank you very much for your presentation. And Dominique is at the head of my research team, so I take care of my career. So I've prepared a gift for him. Thank you very much, Dominique. Merci beaucoup. Thank you. We take 15 minutes for a break, and for people who are connected on the website, we stop until 5:15. Okay?